Hello, everybody. So my name is Virginie Nicolas. I'm lighting designer since 30 years in Concepto Studio, and actually the president of ACE, which is a French Lighting Designer Association. Today, I'd like to share with you some ideas and experience about the new challenge we face. The question of protecting darkness when doing exterior lighting. I'm in the darkness now. No, it's okay. Then, where should light end and where can darkness begin? First, a quick glance to our studio for you to understand better my position. Our company was born 30 years ago, created by Roger Nairboni, who with some friends have really created and developed this profession in France. Basically, he wrote the books all my generation studied when in university. Concepto has today, since 30 years, more than 150 urban lighting master plans in France and abroad. The notion of nighttime landscape, ecology of light, black infrastructure, sustainable lighting, high environmental quality lighting, preservation of nocturnal biodiversity, on which we work since 2001, have been tested in a real context in our recent studies and lighting project. Urban lighting master plan were initiated in the 80s, 20 years after the expansion of the big urban master plans. Urban lighting master plans aim at defining the night strategic orientation of a territory. Before them, cities barely had lighting furniture notebooks. Urban lighting was reduced to reach illuminance levels, who choose that what design you wanted for your fixture, and which churches and bridges you want to enhance. That was all. When you were creative, you structure your streets using different light color, but you had not a lot of possibilities, as there were like sodium, high pressure, mercury, and not other things. So it was merely orange or a little white. Since the 19th century, cities have constantly increased the quantity of light, adding patrimonial lighting to park lighting and so on, till all being lit. And darkness disappeared a little of our cities, and the perception of the sky too. But this lighting approach is changing dramatically today in answer to the climate urgency. Cities need to cut their energy consumption first. For example, Paris decided to reduce from 30% its consumption between 2010 and 2020. But it's a bit easy because of LED. You know, it's quite easy to say, okay, we save a lot of energy, but it's not a lot of effort. So what about darkness? So 80 years ago, we initiated our first dark infrastructure study. Since then, all our urban lighting master plans include dark infrastructures analysis. So we became a shadow designer. Concerning biodiversity, public opinion realizes now the bad impact of an excess of urban lighting in our biodiversity. Not only on birds, insects, but even trees and humans, because it can provide you to sleep well when there's too much lighting, like LEDs and so on. But how can we protect biodiversity when living at night? That's a tricky point. Human activities are more and more nocturnal. In France, since a few years, there are more people working on non-standard working hours than on one standard ones. Means staggered hours and flexible hours are now the standards. So let me introduce our tools we developed to face this question of protecting biodiversity in urban lighting. First, chronotopia analysis. That's an unusual word, but easy to catch. Chrono, it's at what time, and topia, it's where do people really need lights. Before, we were only analyzing things like, oh, there's a street with a road and with a path for pedestrians. So let's put some light for roads and pedestrians. If someone want to walk, there will be light. But that's kind of stupid because you spread out a lot of light and sometimes there's no one. So to analyze the uses is a way of reducing light a lot and to make darkness come back in cities and exterior places. That is in between sociology and lighting analysis. A lot of interviews and night walks will be needed with the very people living there to help you to deeply understand the nocturnal dynamism through whose night hours. Not the one politics and landscapes maker imagine, but the true ones, the true uses of the place, not the one you imagine and you want that people do. We first localize the position of schools, shops, offices, houses, and draw the main road, traffic roads, pedestrian paths, linking the nocturnal polarities. So people sometimes not use a nice pathway you did for them, because there's an ugly one and dangerous one, but it's shorter to go back to their house. So in the same way, people, some squares are alive on weekends, some other every night from spring to autumn. And in some squares, there's no activity at night, so it's useless to put some lights. Lighting designers have to understand this dynamism all over the year, so it's quite complicated. You have to make a lot of light master plan, light maps, and not only one as we used to have. That is a long analysis. Sometimes we need professional people help to dig into all the data and to collect relevant information. You can't improvise that because you need a significant amount of data to make some conclusions, and be careful about that. Don't be too amateur, that's a risk of that because we don't have enough fees, enough time. So some professional sociologists specialize in nighttime could help, like, for example, configuring light team based in London. So when the chronotopia is drawn, the lighting designer can apply classic illuminance standard to each area, but of course, the lowest levels possible. And what about biodiversity now? The second tool is just to dig into biodiversity report. Means as long it is long and difficult to meet the little animals living in the area you're in charge of, the lighting designer should ask for environmental impact reports to identify which nocturnal animal is in the place and which one should particularly be protected. Is it squirrels, bats, frogs, hedgehogs, snails, owls? That depends on the site. Depending on the richness of natural context, that part too could be a long analysis. And sometimes you don't have even the data. But for sure, we saw that in those last years there were more and more impact reports. So it's fine. You just have, it's kind of that big, and you just read it, and it's okay. You find you the answer. Sometimes, again, a little help of an ecology professional helps to understand where those animals live and what they need exactly and when. In the beginning of the night or at the end, that depends on the rhythm of each animal. Is it active in springtime in particular? Voilà, you should know to imagine your lighting. And the third tool is spectrum analysis. You see, we work on the projects in 2 weeks and we didn't even begin to do a calculation. But that's a new lighting design way. But be patient, we are back in now. This is a technical part. Since 2 years, we have great and precise researches that synthesize the impact of each spectrum on each pieces. Some other research explains the impact of illuminance levels and will give the maximum level to reach to preserve this pieces or this other one. But there is one thing to be said, it's unfortunately impossible to preserve all species. There will be always an animal you will disturb, as the photosensibility is different from one animal to the other. There's no perfect light concerning biodiversity preservation. We can only modestly identify priorities and do the less harm possible. As you can see, the yellow-orange LED light is less damaging than the other. But depends on your place. I've made an eco district where snails were particularly protected. And so we do like more green lights. What about, and this is the important part. It's when you have the photosensibility of an animal, you have to put it in relation with the spectrum of the lamps you will use. And you have a large broad of possibilities. So it's not that complicated just to check that the LED you will use or the color lighting you will use is just relevant for the animal you want to protect or not to disturb at minimum. And keep in mind, of course, that the human evolving ear needs light rendering, color, and to see each other. So you can't do a full color project if there are some human involved. So the last part, flickering analysis, that's brand new for us. A lot of studies focus on spectrum, and it's well known for now. But there is another important thing to know. Animals suffer from flickering light. Human eyes consider that 24 pictures a second is a static picture, but the animals don't. The retina persistence frequency is much higher for little animals, in particular fast-moving ones. That's super important because it means that if you put a dimming LED light in the middle of the night to reduce pollution and consumption, you feel good. But you're probably going to create a stroboscopic visual environment for some animals, in particular insects and little birds. I let you imagine what could be the impact of a stroboscopic lighting on a neurological system of this little fellow with four or six legs. So now I will share a little, some experience about what I've said. So the first project, it's the biggest one, not for now, but the one where we made a lot of innovation, it's Rennes. That's a city in France, quite big. The pattern of urbanization, as you can see, in Rennes and its urban community is based on the concept of multipolarity and green belt. So it was there we developed a black framework to complete the green and blue frameworks. Means that in this round you see around the city, we create corridors, dark corridors. And when lowering the levels of lights all around the green area. And in this city in particular, there was quite innovative, and we offered to, and we made it, to make some virtual illumination for patrimonial places. Means that it's completely dark, but there's a tourist program, and when you can go with your tab, with your apps and your phone, and you can discover all the light project we imagine. Next project, it's Saclay. In this place, it's like a big campus university. And there's a line of transportation, a new one. And the bad thing is it's a red one, you see. And it's just passing just in the middle of an ecological corridor. So first, we wanted to make the darkness comfortable. So we study a lot of way of creating some illuminance without light, means using moons, as the Roman did, and to offer some hanging lamps for people when they want to cross the forest, for example. And for sure, all people have a smartphone for now, so it's easy for them just to use it when crossing a little part of the forest. The Welcoming Darkness, it's a large brand of tools with fluorescence and luminescence, means that we are looking for some new materials using very low light and just get back the light during the night. And in the future, well, that was an exhibition we did about imagining that there was no more street lighting, but only people with their own lights. Could be holographic. In this area, in particular, we have this tricky challenge of doing an industrial site just in the middle of the forest. But in this site, people work at night. So how to deal with that? We have a very high levels of illuminance to reach to provide their good light to do their task. But there are all those animals around, and they have to pass and to survive. So the things we did is just to put all the light toward the center of the site first. Then we create, we put amber lights everywhere where it's possible. So I discuss with all people just to know, do you really need that rendering of light, this black light, this white light? And they say, no, it's just a stock, just a place to park. So, okay, let's put amber lights. So that's the way we reduce the quantity of light in this site. And then during the deep night hours, we dimmed a lot and cut a lot of light. In this place, we had two lights, amber and white, and during the dark hours, from the very center of the night, it's in amber to protect biodiversity again. And that's all for now. Thank you.